It's one of Iowa's longest-running and most notorious mysteries.
I think everybody wants to know what happened so it doesn't happen again. And we definitely want to know, too.
What happened to Johnny Gosch?
His family started asking that question 40 years ago today. And four decades later, Johnny's parents still face each day with that painful unknown.
When this happened and the reality sunk in that these people took Johnny, I thought, 48 hours, we'll know something. Well, we didn't.
I cannot believe that somebody has not come forward with information or whatever.
Tonight, KCCI visits the West Des Moines neighborhood where Johnny vanished while on his paper route, leaving his red wagon and bundles of newspapers behind.
It shaped just the rest of my life. Like, you don't stop thinking about it.
We'll take you inside the investigation, showing you what's still being done to this day to find Johnny.
This particular case, it is still open and active at this time.
We also ask whether there's any connection between Johnny Gosch and two other missing Iowa boys.
Nothing, just nothing. It was like it never happened. It was like he never happened.
Does that hurt as a brother?
Yeah.
The mystery that captivated central Iowa, shattered a sense of safety, and made parents hold their children a little tighter starts right now.
KCCI 8 News presents Searching for Johnny, 40 Years Later.
Good evening, I'm Steve Carmen.
And I'm Stacy Horst.
And we're at the corner of 42nd Street and Marquardt Lane in West Des Moines, the exact location of where 12-year-old Johnny Gosch was last seen alive.
Over the next hour, we will go over everything we have learned in the 40 years since Johnny Gosch disappeared from this corner and the questions that still remain.
And we begin tonight with how it all started.
Police are looking for this boy, 12-year-old Johnny Gosch. He's a son of Mr. and Mrs. John Gosch of 1004 45th Street in West Des Moines. The boy was last seen this morning about 6 o'clock as he began his paper route in front of Valley United Methodist Church at 42nd and Ashworth.
That was September 5th, 1982. 40 years later, Johnny Gosch is still missing. The case remains unsolved.
At first, West Des Moines police treated the disappearance as an abduction and launched a big search that included several law enforcement agencies. By the end of the first day, police said they no longer believed that it was an abduction, and they started to treat the case as a missing person or runaway incident. 3 days after Johnny's disappearance, reality set in for his parents, John and Noreen Gosch.
Yet, as they told KCCI 40 years ago, they were still hopeful their son would be found alive.
Day one was shock that this kind of atrocity could happen. It just doesn't seem like it could happen in your neighborhood, 2 blocks from your house. The second day, you realize it really is happening. And finally, by today, it's just gripping every single minute of the day, worrying about his safety, whether he's warm, whether he's had food, all of these things that when days go by, you just wonder if he's even going to come back.
A couple of months into the search, investigators had a composite sketch of a man wanted for questioning, but didn't release it to the public or to Johnny's parents. So the Goshes, along with the private investigator they hired, released their own composites in hopes of generating leads.
And while they waited for those tips to come in, the first big family holiday without their son approached.
Our mode of thinking for Thanksgiving Day in this house will not be a negative tone we'll miss Johnny. There's an empty chair. And any time the family circle cannot be together, it's bad, it's sad. But we are going to remain thankful because we have not had a dead body to contend with.
As they worked to bring Johnny home, the Goshes also lobbied locally and nationally to raise awareness about missing children. 2 years after Johnny's disappearance, the Iowa legislature passed the Johnny Gosch Bill into law, requiring law enforcement to immediately investigate missing child cases. Months later, the action went national when President Reagan signed the Missing Children's Act.
Then, 3 years later in 1988, the FBI provided a new way to help find Johnny. For the first time, the investigators used face aging technology on a missing person. That technology worked off the last picture taken of Johnny, combining some of his features with those of his parents to create the picture.
I've been thinking, what would it be like if he were brought into the room today? You know, how's he going to have changed? Will he have a beard? Will he, you know, he would be obviously old enough to shave now. All these changes that other kids gradually go through, we will be faced with on the spot. And it'll be a shock for both he and us if he is found alive.
It's 1991. Nebraska prison inmate Paul Benassi comes forward with a startling claim that a network of pedophiles forced him to help abduct Johnny Gosch. Benassi was serving time for sexual assault on a child. West Des Moines police never did question Benassi on their own.
Noreen Gosch was called to testify in his 1999 trial, and that's when she made a bombshell claim of her own that Johnny visited her in her home 2 years earlier for about an hour.
He told me how he was kidnapped. At first he was so drugged that he didn't know where he was at, but he could then relate some of the names of the people that were around him, that he was able to latch on to names. He told me how they traveled all over the country. They were used for pornography, prostitution, compromising businessmen and politicians sexually. These kids were used in a royal fashion like none of us would ever dream of.
A West Des Moines police officer said that Noreen had told similar stories before, only to recant them later. There were never any witnesses that verified her claim.
John Gosch, who by then was divorced from Noreen, has said he's not sure that visit ever happened. 40 years later, Johnny Gosch is still missing.
And if Johnny is still alive, he would be 52 years old. And this is what the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children thinks he could look like.
You see a middle-aged man with light brown hair, graying at the temples, wrinkles on his face, with blue eyes. It's in stark contrast to the picture on the left, the one we all know, 12-year-old Johnny Gosch, a young boy frozen in time. The lives of Noreen Gosch and John Gosch have been frozen too, in a way.
Their world forever changed when Johnny never returned home from his paper route. John and Noreen Gosch told KCCI's Todd Magel how they've moved forward without their son after 40 years.
What goes through my mind at this point in time, 40 years at this, is what did I miss? What thing would there have been that might have changed the course of the investigation?
I still think of Johnny as a 12-year-old. I don't think of him as a 50-year-old adult now. What I think of most is that I cannot believe that somebody has not come forward with information or whatever.
John and Noreen Gosch are living with a painful 40-year-old mystery, a mystery that may never be solved. What happened to their 12-year-old son, Johnny, on a quiet Sunday morning in 1982?
My belief is based on what I've learned through the information we got that we could verify. And that was that he was kidnapped off the street while doing his paper route, and he was put into what they now call human trafficking.
And everybody wants to know, you want to know, it's just such a mystery. What do you think happened to him?
I have no idea. No idea.
John and Noreen Gosch no longer live in this West Des Moines neighborhood. They've been divorced for years. Noreen lives in Northeast Iowa now. John lives in Arizona. In fact, he drove to a nearby cell phone tower to get enough bandwidth to do a Zoom interview with us.
Probably, chances are pretty high that he never will be found, along with lots of other kids.
Will he ever be found?
I don't know that he would. I don't. And at this very second, I don't know if he's alive or not right now.
What is life like now for John and Noreen?
It crosses my mind usually some part of every day, but I have a life too. And 40 years also means everything slows down. There isn't the day-to-day need for action.
I think about it all the time. every time I'm driving, if I see something white in the ditch, my eyes go directly toward it. He was wearing a white sweatshirt, Kim's Academy sweatshirt, apparently, when he was taken. And so that is locked into my brain, that something white out there that I look at all the time.
When days go by, you just wonder if he's even going to come back.
After Johnny disappeared, the Goshes became known worldwide. The investigation continued for days, weeks, months, now decades. They worked nonstop trying to find their son. 40 years later, life has calmed down.
And now I'm at a point in my life where I can have a life and some happiness and some good times too. And it makes a difference, it helps.
They wonder what Johnny would be like at age 52, what he missed after 40 years.
It's just hard to even think that way. Hoping that he would have went through college like his brother and sister did and all that stuff, but it just stops at 12 years old.
The Goshes say they will never give up hope, and time does have a way of healing their wounds.
The hope is pretty well gone. I just would like to have a closure before I die, you know, but you just don't know.
And I would like to hope that Johnny would be still alive and I would be able to spend some time with him before my demise. Actually, it's more than just a hope. It is a real wish to have that happen.
Noreen said it. She is holding out hope that Johnny is still alive.
But if he is, why hasn't he come forward? Noreen shares her theory later in this hour.
But coming up next, we're taking you inside the investigation to find answers 4 decades later, how that effort has changed over the years, and what West Des Moines police are still doing to this day to find Johnny Gosch. Plus, for the first time ever, see inside the evidence room where decades of clues have been collected.
And a little later, from quiet to a crime scene. This West Des Moines neighborhood looks pretty typical, unless you know what happened here. We'll hear from some of the people who know Johnny as more than just a face on a flyer. He was the paper delivery boy down the street.
I would like to speak directly to the people who are holding our son. Contact us, please. We'll meet your demands. This is a plea for you to release our son safely, to return him to us alive and well.
When Johnny Gosch first disappeared, the West Des Moines Police Department launched a huge search and investigation. Early on, John and Noreen Gosch criticized the department and hired their own private investigators to try to bring Johnny home.
KCCI's Todd Magel shows us what's being done 40 years later to find closure.
Our ultimate goal is to bring closure to everybody that knew and loved Johnny.
Johnny Gosch has been missing for 40 years, vanished from his Sunday morning paper route in West Des Moines. Since that day in 1982, West Des Moines police have been working to find him. It's one of the oldest investigations in the department's history.
This particular case, it is still open and active at this time. We do have detectives that are assigned to this case, and they do periodically still review that case file. We do receive tips and leads occasionally, multiple times a year. Of course, we have to vet those tips and make sure that they're credible. We need to look through all of those things. A lot of times they end up not being credible, or they could be hearsay. And sometimes they're tips and leads that we've already followed up on in the past that the public may not be aware of. So there's a lot of aspects to this case that we can't really comment on because the case is still open.
Police can't say what those tips are. They can't say if they think Johnny is still alive. They can't say if they have any theories about what happened that day.
Being as the case is still open and detectives and the other law enforcement agencies are still actively working it, we don't comment on any theories that we might have in the case at this time.
It's no surprise that after 40 years, West Des Moines police have a lot of evidence in the Johnny Gosch case. They can't show us that evidence, but for the first time in 4 decades, they can show us where that evidence is, right here in the West Des Moines Police Department. Here's an exclusive look at the secure West Des Moines Police Evidence Room. Inside, on a top shelf 20 feet in the air, 4 storage boxes marked Johnny Gosch, each filled with physical evidence from that September day in 1982, and days, weeks, months, years since then. It's a powerful reminder that the investigation is an old case,
but not a cold case.
These cases are very important to keep that evidence intact and to keep it preserved. We may end up getting a lead at some point in the future where that evidence is critical to bring closure to this case.
But West Des Moines Police Sergeant Jason Heitz admits solving the Gosch case is a challenge.
With the size of this case and the time span that's gone by since this case began, sometimes it takes a long time to go through those case files, and many of our detectives now are retired or deceased or they're aging, and those resources are starting to disappear that had intimate knowledge of the case in the past. So it does take a little more effort, but with technology and digitizing these cases now, we're working on those things and trying to keep it moving as efficiently as we can.
We do have an active case for Johnny Gosch here at the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children.
John Bischoff is Vice President of Missing Children at the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. The Johnny Gosch case is one of many that prompted Congress to form the nonprofit organization in 1984. It works hand in hand with law enforcement, and Bischoff says many law enforcement techniques and technologies have changed since then.
Time is of the essence, and it is one of the bigger things that have changed over the years. But believe it or not, even today, we're fighting with that perception from the public that there is some perceived waiting period when that is absolutely not the case.
Noreen Gosch lobbied the Iowa legislature to force police to act more quickly after Johnny's disappearance. It's called the Johnny Gosch Bill.
And that ensures that there's an immediate investigation. No more waiting 72 hours. You don't do that on a bank robbery. Why would you for a human being?
It's very critical to try to find a child or a missing person within that first 24 hours is really the window when to work on that. And those things have changed over time. Things are different now, investigative practices are different now, and reporting is different now.
Another big change, instead of milk cartons and signs painted on trucks, the internet and other high-tech tools have revolutionized the way missing kids are investigated.
Back then, it was difficult to share information in an expedited fashion. Now we have certain things such as Amber Alerts, we have the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, we have social media outlets, and a whole host of other technology that can help us work these cases in a more expedited fashion.
In the last 30 years, the FBI reports missing children cases have dropped by 40%, but that's cold comfort when so many cases remain unsolved.
It doesn't matter that 40 years have passed. We'll still continue to look for Johnny Gosch, and until told otherwise, until proven otherwise, we won't stop.
The goal that we have is to bring him home and reunite him with his family. And we hope that someday that happens, and we'll do everything that we can to assist that process.
Johnny's disappearance happened really close to those who would investigate his case.
The West Des Moines police station back then was less than a mile from here, at the corner of Valley West Drive and Ashworth Road. And for those in this neighborhood, September 5th, 1982 is a day that seemed to change everything. Still ahead, we're hearing from people who saw the case play out firsthand 40 years ago, right in front of their homes.
And he went from reporter to confidant, standing by the Goshes all these years. Next, what he's helped them achieve over 40 years of searching for Johnny.
We'll start fanning out the creek here, and we'll walk this Greenbelt Park all the way through.
But law enforcement agents are still waiting for some solid leads, including information about the two cars seen in the area of John's disappearance Sunday morning. Officers say the investigation will continue.
Well, we continue on. We've got a lot of information we're sorting through. Our teams are checking out leads as they come in. I'm sure the search will continue tomorrow.
Is this still being treated as a missing persons case at this point?
Yes, it is.
You don't think it's a kidnapping, though, do you?
I'm not ruling out anything, but I have nothing to indicate that it was a kidnapping.
Do you think you would have heard from the kidnappers by now if it was a kidnapping?
I would state that normally, yes.
Local journalist who covered this story ended up becoming dear friends with the Goshes. Ron Sampson covered this story from the start.
He shared with KCCI's Todd Magel the memories he's collected over the years of advocating for finding Johnny Gosch.
Just the fact that you can be two blocks from your house, disappear, and not one clue in 40 years. There's just no describing it.
Still, Ron Sampson has spent 40 years trying to describe the case of Johnny Gosch.
My notes to myself from the very first time I met John and Noreen.
Sampson still has briefcases full of files filled with Gosch information. Sampson was a young columnist for a suburban weekly newspaper when he filed his first report on the Gosch case.
I was asked to come over and interview John and Noreen by one of my readers of the Ankeny Press Citizen. And I gladly did it, and I was hooked.
He was hooked by the agonizing mystery.
The papers were still there. The wagon was still there. The rubber bands were still there. Gretchen, the dachshund, had walked home without him. That's it. That's your first clue. I mean, there is no clue.
He remembers the frustration.
Well, the thing that probably was most wrong is that it was the first time for anything like this for anybody. Nobody in this area had any expertise on this.
He not only reported on the news story, he and his wife became friends with the Gosches.
What I learned is that we didn't know much. And John and Noreen were plowing new ground as far as searches, as far as legislation. This is just something nobody had experienced. And so we were desperate for information.
Eventually, the missing persons case took on a life of its own. Johnny appeared on a milk carton.
I think AE approached us first, and that was a first anywhere nationally.
A trucker asked to put Johnny's face on his big rig.
And then we were approached by a trucker here in the Des Moines market that wanted to put it on the side of his truck and drive it across the country.
Sampson says one of his most satisfying moments was see the Gosches help create new legislation to speed up the process of finding missing kids.
You don't wait 24 hours, you don't wait 48 hours, you don't wait 72 hours. The police have to get on any kind of a report of a missing child. People probably don't remember that was kind of the norm of the day, but we didn't know any better. And we learned the hard way that it is the better way to do it.
Back in 2017, John Gosch lent Johnny's red wagon to Sampson to display at the Iowa State Fair. It's the same wagon found on the sidewalk the day he disappeared, a piece of Central Iowa history.
This is the last thing that Johnny touched. It is what John found when Johnny hadn't delivered his papers. Think of the significance of that wagon. I mean, I'm getting the chill sitting here, and it's 105 degrees.
What does he think happened?
My story was he was taken on a Sunday morning, and he's never been heard from since. And we don't know who took him. We don't know why they took him. We don't know if it was a pedophile or a molester. We don't know anything. If it was just somebody who took him for a few minutes or we just don't know.
Sampson is worried he may never know what happened to Johnny Gosch.
Tada, okay, I'm 70 years old, gonna be 70 years old here shortly. I've been doing this now for 40 years, over half of my life. I've raised my sons. My wife and I have been friends of Gosch's. It has been part of our lives. And there isn't a day that goes by, obviously, that I don't think about it.
Iowa journalists have covered this mystery endlessly. Many have retired without ever knowing the fate of Johnny Gosch.
They say time heals all wounds. Don't think it heals this one.
Next, we will talk with current and former KCCI journalists who have covered every twist and turn of this disappearance.
And a neighborhood forever changed. See the search for Johnny through the eyes of those who watched it firsthand, and the little moments they'll never forget 40 years later.
With little to go on, police turn an eye on early morning routine, exactly to the hour when 12-year-old John Gosch suddenly vanished on his paper route 1 week ago. Officers stop motorists at several intersections to see if they routinely drove in the neighborhood just before dawn. Police were looking for possible witnesses or for any suspicious activities. Authorities learn nothing new and say they still have no solid evidence the boy was abducted. Nevertheless, many parents who ordinarily wouldn't accompany their children did so today. Also, the paper kept closer tabs today on its 2,000 Des Moines carriers.
That happened in our neighborhood.
It affected all of us.
This felt like the safest neighborhood ever. You just didn't come out at night anymore. It just seemed there was just a real fear.
Johnny Gosch grew up where so many parents would love to raise their kids, in suburban surroundings at the end of a quiet street.
And that's how this West Des Moines neighborhood remains today. But as KCCI's Eric Hansen shows us, the people who lived here know that can change in an instant.
Just north of Ashworth Road in West Des Moines, 45th Street is a one-block-long cul-de-sac with only 10 homes.
Do you remember that?
Including the one on the west side, where Jerry Archambault and her husband moved in the late 70s.
There were no trees. We were all putting trees in. I planted every tree on that lot.
Because back then, this neighborhood, just a few blocks west of Valley High School, was the very edge of the metro.
Brand new. The whole block was.
Filled with young families about the same age.
Oh, we were all so social. We would come out at night and stand around drinking beer and talking.
Which is when Jerry met her neighbors two doors down, John and Noreen Gosch. The couples had kids the same age.
If she had an engagement to go to, I would take care of Johnny. And if I had something to do, she'd take care of Gene.
Today, the neighborhood is full of mature trees. Back in the early 80s, the trees in this neighborhood were smaller and the cars were bigger.
So many memories.
Jerry's daughter, Sherry, was a junior in high school.
We used to put a basketball court, one of those portable ones, in the cul-de-sac, and everybody came out.
Including Johnny, the boy everyone around here knew for running around the neighborhood and for his job as the morning paper boy.
Johnny used to take his wagon and then you had to fold your own papers and rubber band them. And I only know that because we all subbed on that paper route. When Johnny would be gone or out of town, everybody would fill in.
We knew pretty much everyone on our street.
John Lipovac knew the routine. His route was just a few blocks east.
You'd go knocking on their door once a month and try to catch them at home and collect their $3.75 for a month's worth of papers or whatever.
He delivered to about 40 neighbors and never thought twice about leaving home alone at 4 a.m.
Yep, totally safe. We could leave the house, ride our bikes, take off.
Until?
It was a Sunday morning.
September 5th, 1982. The headlines about the USDA were not big, but no one here saw them.
My husband was furious he hadn't gotten the paper. He was an early riser up at 4 o'clock.
No paper until Johnny's dad, John, delivered them. But there were plenty of cops right at sunrise.
I said to Bill, I said, there's something going on. But our focus was to get to church.
We went to church, came home, and then more police cars. And then everybody's coming outside of their houses trying to figure out what's going on.
I went out in the garage to get a Sara Lee coffee cake. And I looked out the side door and I saw Noreen up there talking to what I know now were the FBI agents. And I came in and said to my husband, I said, I need to go see if we can help. And he says, go ahead. And he gave me a big hug. That's when I found out Johnny was gone.
Johnny's dog, Gretchen, had been with him.
And the dog had walked home. And just as the day went on, it was like, oh, surely he'll show up and come back wherever he wandered off to.
We never did finish making breakfast. We told the girls we were going to be gone all day. And they had to finish making breakfast. We wanted to help.
I remember walking cornfields and we all were in a row so nobody missed anything. And you just walked and walked thinking that he was out there in those cornfields.
That first day, some thought he'd run away.
Everybody asked me, what did you think? And I said, I think he's been abducted. He was the biggest kid on the corner. Johnny was very big for his age.
Exactly what Johnny's mom, two doors down, thought too.
Our son was taken off the corner of 42nd and Marquardt. I don't believe for one minute that he ran away or walked voluntarily with anyone.
By evening, everyone in town was suddenly scared.
My grandma called my parents right away when she heard it on the news later that day or that night. And, she heard about this paper boy named John that was gone missing, so she freaked out and called mom and dad, and that settled that right away.
Her West Des Moines paperboy named John was safe, but within days, 2,000 carriers all over the metro suddenly had parent chaperones. Back on 45th.
It just changed the neighborhood completely. We were very supportive, trying to help in any way we could, but people just didn't come out of their houses anymore.
Sherry didn't even like coming home from Valley football games after dark.
The house has changed now, but it used to have the brick arch, and I always thought somebody was lurking inside that. I just didn't want to get out of the car.
Today, Ring doorbells record every movement. But back then, clues weren't captured, and that unknown freaked everyone out.
But then it just became a thing, like, we have to be safe. This has to be locked up so that the boogeyman can't come get you.
I remember the fair the following year. They had the kids tied to them on leashes. I mean, it changed the whole world.
It's hard to believe 40 years, yeah.
Lee Dunham moved to the corner of 42nd and Marquardt 8 years ago, 32 years after Johnny's red wagon was found here.
No, I didn't realize that until that first summer that we lived here, that somebody stopped and was saying that this was kind of a sad little corner. And I said, why is that? And they said, this is where Johnny Gosch was kidnapped from.
The mystery he'd followed when he'd lived on Des Moines' south side was suddenly right outside his door.
Even today, we have a little kid's bus pickup, and I get up real early in the morning, and I always sit in there, drink my coffee to keep an eye out.
It's hard to look at that house and not think of everything that happened.
Where they watched the Goshes do so many interviews.
We admired Noreen. It took somebody like her to keep, her goal was to keep Johnny's name at the top of the list, especially on the anniversaries. She's been pretty successful.
Returning home to 45th Street.
For me, it brings back all these memories.
What happened here is why decades later, Sherry didn't let her boys ride bikes to elementary school alone.
It shaped just the rest of my life. Like, you don't stop thinking about it.
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
They changed, just like this neighborhood.
Great neighborhood now.
But
it happened here. It's just unbelievable that it happened here.
And
it affected all of us.
Eric Hansen, KCCI 8 News.
How does that happen in our neighborhood?
Iowa's News Leader.
What's striking about this corner where Johnny disappeared is that it's so ordinary. No plaque or marker to indicate this is where one of Iowa's biggest mysteries began.
While there is no official marker here, journalists who've covered this story for four decades need no reminder. Tonight we talked to two veteran KCCI journalists about covering the twists and turns of such a high-profile case.
Well, I think I was the first journalist by happenstance to find out about the story, simply because my wife and I were on our way to church that morning, and as I drove past the corner of 42nd and Marquardt to our church one block from that intersection, I saw a number of people standing around, a number of police cars, a number of police officers outside the vehicles. So I pulled into the church parking lot, my wife went inside the church, I walked over, being the nosy reporter, to find out what was going on. And I would say things were calm, but I asked somebody, I don't even remember if it was an officer or a neighbor, hey, what's going on? Well, the paper boy didn't come home.
When a story breaks, sometimes it can be difficult to recognize how big it will become. Former KCCI News Director Dave Buzik covered thousands of stories before he retired. From horrible plane crashes to the floods of 93, Buzik has seen it all. He wasn't sure how this story would play out at the time.
We had a reporter and photographer on that Sunday and suggested they come on out and at least get some video of the scene. You know, if the kid comes home, it's not a story. But if the kid doesn't come home, it's probably going to be a story. Turns out the kid didn't come home and it's a story.
After the boy folded his papers and loaded his wagon, he walked a block north on 42nd Street and turned here at Marquardt Lane. A while later, the boy's father found the wagon with newspapers blowing in the wind.
And journalists stayed on the story for days, weeks, months, and eventually years.
As time went on and Johnny didn't return, not the first day, not the second day, not the third day, not a month later, not a year later, clearly there was a great deal of concern.
Concern not only for Johnny Gosch, but also for the kids who were still delivering newspapers.
Steve Kramus, Metro Circulation Manager, ordered the department's 49 supervisors to drive through their districts and oversee morning deliveries.
It cuts close to home for me because 7 years before Johnny went missing, I was a Des Moines Register newspaper carrier with the same Sunday morning route in my neighborhood. And In those days, you just kind of take things for granted and that you're going to be fine. But now that I think about it, you know, I was a paper boy 7 years before he went missing. And wow, that's a hard reality to think about it.
KCCI photojournalist Courtney Kintzer began his career when he was just 17 years old. He says he can't compare this cold case to any others he's seen through the years.
Nothing to this, absolutely nothing to this magnitude, that the story that's gone on this long, and then it's just been a cold cold case. I mean, it's the mystery of mysteries.
This is an important story, and I hope one day this community gets to find out what happened.
The Goshers say there has now been a total, complete break with the West Des Moines Police Department. They say the department's lack of experience in child abduction cases has resulted in uncooperativeness and a failure to do many basic things that were needed.
Journalists were well aware of the conflict between Johnny's parents and police, and it became a big part of the story.
The police chief in West Des Moines at the time, a guy by the name of Warville Cooney, was kind of an old school guy who'd come up through the ranks, and he and Noreen were like oil and water. Noreen's emotions are very much out front. Orville Cooney didn't react to that kind of thing. So I think that there was a sense that they were getting beat up by Noreen, by the media, and police kind of pulled the ranks in a little bit tighter and kept her at bay. So it really was just a bad situation in terms of an easy flow of communication. There was not a lot of trust between the family and the police department out there, and that didn't serve any of those people well.
While journalists try to detach their own feelings from a story, both Buzik and Kintzer say, after so many years, that's nearly impossible.
As a photojournalist, you know, you do have to separate yourself emotionally, but at the same time you're human. And you can't help but feel for the parents and just think about, wow, what if that was, you know, my child? You just can't even imagine going through that. I know I can't, still can't.
Well, personally, I've always cared about the story. I've always cared about Noreen. I think that she has helped other families who've gone through this. I think that she's been a rock. I had hoped by the end of my career a couple of years ago that maybe something would be known about this case, but it hasn't happened. The world has changed a lot in so many ways over 40 years, and yet this pain of a parent losing a child is something everyone can relate to, and it's just a horrible tragedy that, for everyone's sake, I wish there could be some information that would at least give people some closure on it. But here we are. The fact that we're talking about it some 40 years later, it's an open wound on this community. It's certainly an open wound for that family, and I don't know that it's ever going to completely heal over. They say time heals all wounds. Don't think it heals this one.
Johnny Gosch was the first of three boys to disappear in the Des Moines area in the 1980s. When we come back, the similar circumstances that left these kids missing and whether the cases could be connected.
Plus, Noreen Gosch still has hope that she will see her son before she dies. Why she thinks he can't come home if he's still alive.
In a news conference today, the Goshes say they recently learned of 25 leads the police department had never told them about. They say it's crucial they know about the leads.
I personally do not think that any law enforcement agent in this country has the right to sign a death warrant on any child. If there's a lead that comes in from the Missing Children's Center in Washington, that may be a good lead, and the law enforcement, especially West Des Moines Police Department, does not check it out. We know that our private investigators will check it out.
Other police departments sit down with the parents and go over things, so there is communication, so the parents know that something is being done for their child.
Two other boys, roughly the same age, Eugene Martin and Mark Allen, disappeared within a couple of years of Johnny in Des Moines. Neither case was ever solved.
And neither case got the same kind of attention that the Gosch case did. KCCI's James Stratton takes a look at why, and we'll hear from their families nearly 40 years after they disappeared.
Why don't people remember the name Mark Allen?
Because it never got any publicity. It never got treated seriously. I mean, it was like it happened and then it was over. It was just that fast. There was no, to my knowledge, there was no news broadcastings. There was, you know, nothing in the paper. There was, you know, nothing, just nothing. It was like it never happened. It was like he never happened.
Does that hurt as a brother?
Yeah.
36 years after his brother, Mark Allen, disappeared, it's hard to even find photos of the 13-year-old.
It seemed like every single one that I did find, it was the back of his head or something.
But a younger brother doesn't forget the memories of his older one, including the day he was last seen in March 1986.
I can remember the feeling of desperation in the house, of not knowing where he was.
Allen was heading to a friend's house from his on Emma Avenue on Des Moines' south side, and never showed up, never returned, and was never seen again.
With Mark Allen's case, it started off as a runaway, and then over time, you look at it and say, "This something else is going on here."
That something else is a missing boy who likely isn't a runaway.
I don't know if I lose hope. I just recently decided, you know, I want answers.
Mark Allen vanished 4 years after Johnny Gosch and 2 years after Eugene Martin, another paperboy who disappeared, this time near Southwest 14th Street and Highview Drive.
He's always there. We're talking about him every day anyway. We don't forget him. I don't think we ever will, no matter what happens.
KCCI was there as Eugene Martin's family gathered for their first Christmas without him. They've since been through 36 more.
We kept Christmas presents from him for almost 5-6 years. We just kept them.
Martin was delivering papers on a Sunday morning and, like Gosch, was never seen again.
I want to believe that he's still alive. And whoever's got him, all they have to do is let us know where he's at, and we'll go get him and bring him home. But if he is dead, I still want to know so we can bring him home and give him a decent burial.
That closure never came for the Martin family. His sister, Kim DeLacca, still longs for it.
And it's just like a weird nightmare. You think it's just a bad dream at first, and then you realize down the road it's not a bad dream. It really happened, and he's gone.
Kim was 16 when that weird nightmare of her brother disappearing happened, but she still holds out hope that he's still out there.
Maybe he would see it if he's still around. That's why I came down to the interview.
Des Moines police say they followed every lead they could.
It fills an entire filing cabinet, a full-size office filing cabinet. Those tips have filled to the brim.
The one question on everyone's mind, are the disappearances of Johnny Gosch, Mark Allen, and Eugene Martin possibly connected?
That's one of the questions that just pounds on us that we would love to have an answer for. If you could connect the cases, it might make the investigation, you know, go a little quicker in one direction or another. But so far, investigators, with all the information sharing we've done, we've not found a connection.
Both cases, now more than 30 years later, are cold, according to Sergeant Paul Parizic.
They go cold because of the lack of information coming in. So you always hope that there's that one piece that we're looking for.
Yeah, they did.
That one piece, that one something to solve these two cases.
We still think about him, you know, daily. One way or another, just want closure.
My mom and dad never gave up hope on him. So as long as they thought he was still out there, then I assumed the same thing.
Hoping that yet another news story, another sharing of their story, that could lead to a cold case getting solved.
Noreen Gosch still believes Johnny was kidnapped and forced into a child trafficking operation. Some people say if he's still alive, why didn't he just call for help or run? Noreen says it's not that simple.
I don't know for certain if he is living. The one thing I do know from talking to other victims of this type of crime is that some of the other young men, and they are men now, said that they would never come back out in the public and be known. It's too hard for them because everybody, if there's been much of a search, everybody knows exactly what happened to them, and they would be very afraid to be out in that type of an arena, and they would certainly draw a lot of attention, and they don't want that, you know. There was a group of the boys, and I was working with an investigator who had been a detective in New York. And during his years there, this was his specific job, was the trafficking. And he thought that Johnny's case met that criteria. So when he retired, he then had time and he really helped me. Well, we came upon information where there was a group of the boys. At that time, they were much younger. And we offered them protection if they would come forward and tell their stories. Johnny was among them. There was about 8 boys. And they all knew one another because they were kept prisoner in different locations together. So they got to know each other. Not one of them said that they would come forward, even with a guarantee as best we could to offer them protection, because they were afraid that if they tried to come forth with what they knew, that their families would die, or they would, because those were the threats they received through all their years. So if you take a child 10 to 12 years old out of their environment at home, no school, no friends, not even anything that they owned would they have with them. And you put them in that type of situation where they're threatened every day of their life. If you run, if you try to contact your family, we'll kill you, or we'll kill your mother, your brother, your sister, whatever you have. And some of the kids that have been in that situation have told me that's the threats they lived with every day. Well, after a while, you become pretty afraid of anything that moves. You wouldn't take a risk. And so I think that's the mindset with a lot of them.
While there are many theories about what could have happened to Johnny, we still don't have the answers.
Coming up next, how many children are reported missing every month in the United States and the resources available to families?
It's every parent's nightmare, a child who fails to come home after school. Anytime a child turns up missing, the frightening cases of Johnny Gosch and Eugene Martin come to mind. But the majority of Iowa's missing children are runaways, and most of them eventually are found. Whether or not a child is considered a runaway, though, a new law, the so-called Johnny Gosch Law, says police must investigate immediately.
We just wanted some type of uniform system, so that whenever a child was missing, each child would get that attention. Not one child get more attention than another, because our organization believes that no matter if a child is a runaway or abducted, that child is missing and that child is in danger and they need to be found.
Before we go tonight, we do want to acknowledge that while the disappearance of Johnny Gosch is tragic, mysterious, and unsettling, he is just one missing child creating heartache for his family.
According to the latest numbers from the FBI, there are more than 30,000 children under the age of 18 who go missing in the United States every month.
There are many reasons for their disappearances, from children with autism who just wander away, to sex trafficking, to family abductions, and more.
The National Center for Missing and Exploited Children has resources for families to help prevent tragedies like this. As for Johnny Gosch, his family has gone 40 years waiting for answers, and they are still hoping to see him again.
If you have a tip that can help bring Johnny home, contact the West Des Moines Police. Their number is 515-222-3399.
Thank you for watching this KCCI 8 News special, Searching for Johnny 40 Years Later.
If you've missed any part of this special, or if you'd like to watch it again, you can do so at KCCI.com or at KCCI's very local streaming app. Thank you for joining us, and have a good evening.